Good morning, interweb. Worldbuilders log 40. We are continuing to worldbuild our fictional planet here, placeholder name Cretac. Last time around, we chucked in some sea climates. This time around, we're finishing up our climate zone map by placing our D climates, our continental climates. But like, what even is a continental climate? Answer, these boils. Now, there's like 12 subtypes here, so I really, for the sake of time, do not want to get into it. But TLDR, continental climates are defined by wild temperature swings between summer and winter, and like as having four distinct seasons. That's about it in terms of unifying this mad array of diversity here. Real fast, all the bluey regions here, these are your humid continental climates. All the pink-ish regions are Mediterranean-influenced continental climates. The dark teal here is your subarctic continental climate, and the purple looking zones here are your monsoon influenced continental climate. Like I said, I don't really want to get into the details here because there's just so much to do. D climates are tricky. So if you want to learn more about continental climates, I want to plug Geodiode. Wonderful, wonderful, wonderful YouTube channel. They have a playlist called Secrets of World Climate Series, and it will teach you everything you want to know about each of the climate zones. So go check out their continental and subarctic videos. Links in all the usual places. And with that, let us get mapping. So just like the last time, we're going to mark in a general like climate band, our general D climate band, and then subdivide it later. By definition, D climates go in regions where the winter temperatures are below 0 degrees Celsius and the summer temperatures are above 10 degrees Celsius. I won't bore you with a time lapse here. For Janar, that region looks like this. Delightful. Now, for those of you who put all your bonus points into observation, you'll note that the D climate band here overlaps some of our arid climates. Bit weird, right? Wrong. As you'll see, some of these arid climates, they aren't really arid climates, they're kind of sneaky D climates in disguise. And to understand why this is, we're going to need to talk evapotranspiration. So evaporation is the vaporization of liquid off a surface. Transpiration is the removal of water from the leaves of plants. Evapotranspiration. I'm just going to use the word evaporation from now on. It's the one we're more kind of like colloquially familiar with. Point is, on any given Earth-like planet, every single region on said planet will receive some degree of precipitation. You go to the driest possible place on Earth, it will still receive some precipitation. It won't be a lot of precipitation, but it'll be non-zero. So using precipitation alone, you can't really determine what regions are arid or not, at least outside of the tropics. You have to balance that with evaporation. So let's say we have two regions here that we have marked as being arid using our methodology from the arid climate zones video, links in all the usual places. Let's say this region here, it gets a minimal amount of precipitation, the blue arrow, but it has like maximum evaporation. Very little water enters the region, and what little makes it in gets immediately yeeted. So it would be safe to say that this is an arid region. There's basically no moisture knocking around. So this would be a B climate. Delightful. But what about this region here? This receives the same, this is important, level of minimal precipitation, but it also experiences minimal evaporation. Is this an arid region? Is this a B region? Well, not really, right? Because barely any water is making it into the region. But at the same time, it's not really evaporating away very quickly. So it's kind of lingering on the surface and in the groundwater. So it's kind of non-arid. Therefore, this B region is actually more like a D region. So we're going to have to take a quick look, a more granular look at precipitation. And we need to look at evaporation. And basically the key thing with evaporation is temperature. If you have a low temperature, the rate of evaporation won't be very strong. If there's a high temperature, the rate of evaporation will increase, right? Makes sense. If you're boiling a pot of water, you put it on boil to boil off the water. If you just put it on the stove and put on like minimal temperature, the water is not going to evaporate very quickly at all. So we're going to need to hunt for areas of our planet where the evaporation is low enough such that our B climates are shifted into the D climate zone. Doing this is a multi-step process. Shock horror for this channel, I know. And it begins with the checking of temperature. We need to get an annual average temperature for each of these regions, each of our arid regions within our D zone. That is step one. So for example, we did this last time around, but just to recap, for example, let's hone in on this little arid region here. We'll chuck on our winter temperature map, take the temperature location, let's say this location here, and let's say that's negative 30, so let's call that negative 31 in winter, cyan for winter. Draw on the summer map, get a red color for summer. This is my 12 degree isotherm, this is my 18 degree isotherm. Halfway in between, say 15 degrees. Take the average, so minus 31 plus 15 is negative 16, divide by 2 is negative 8. So that's the average annual temperature in this region. So we're going to do the same thing for every region. Again, I'm not going to bore you with time-lapse here because there's so much to do. This is the result. How many checks you do, it's entirely dependent on you, the level of detail you'd like to go into, and also just how complicated your landforms are. Janar is, you know, quite flat for the most part, so I don't need to do that many checks. In the more mountainous regions, I went a bit more ham. I needed more info. So I have my average annual temperatures. Again, that's important because remember, high temperature, increased evaporation, low temperature, decreased evaporation. Now we just need to find out where's the cutoff point between high evaporation and low evaporation. And to do that, we're going to need to take a more granular look at precipitation. Namely, we are going to divide precipitation up into kind of 5 degrees, high to minimal. That is, up until this point, we've been working on a precipitation method that has 3 degrees, dry, wet, and very wet. This worked out really well for a good chunk of the globe, but with regards to D climates, it's not sufficient. We're going to need to go more granular, high to minimal. And the basic methodology here is that we're going to target a region, we're going to find a region, and we're going to ask, does it receive onshore winds? Then we're going to ask, in what season does it receive onshore winds? How far is it from the ocean? And is the region affected by any mountain ranges? Doing this kind of algorithm will place us somewhere in this table. Let's just say, for argument's sake, we run the algorithm and we come out here. This is the important thing. If the region we're looking at, if its annual average temperature is less than whatever we output here, that region is no longer considered a B region. We reclassify it as a D region. Hopefully that made sense. Let's do one region together. I'll walk you through it, talking as I go, and then I'll just complete the rest of them off camera, just because it's the same basic routine every single time. So let's go with maybe this chap down here. So if this arid region here intersected by our D band. First up, does it receive onshore winds, and in what season? So we'll throw on our summer precipitation map here, and we see that yes, this region here receives onshore winds in the summer, and yes, it receives onshore winds in the winter. So our output is going to be in the all year round column. Now, when I say onshore here, I really mean onshore. So it doesn't matter how far away the region you're looking at is from the coast. If the winds are onshore, it counts as onshore. It doesn't matter how many mountain ranges the winds cross to get to the region you're looking at, it counts as onshore. It doesn't matter the height of the mountain ranges. If it is in any way onshore, it's onshore. Because remember, every part of the planet will get some precipitation. Oh, and if for whatever reason there's absolutely no onshore winds at all, then you're simply output this value here. That's what this line is referring to down here. No onshore winds, you choose all year minimal. Okay, just heads up. Okay, so we're onshore winds all year round. Cool. We go over to the rightmost column here, the high precipitation column, and we start our journey here. We continue by asking, how far away is the region we're looking at from the ocean? And the algorithm here is that for every 1,000 kilometers, over 3,000 kilometers away from the ocean, we move one column to the left. Okay, so if you were 5,000 kilometers away from the ocean, you would move one column, two columns to the left, etc. Now, in this region here, I mean, look, we're right up against the ocean. There's no way this distance is 3,000 kilometers in the onshore wind direction in either season. So we stay where we are. We don't move leftwards. Next, we ask, are we crossing any mountain ranges? And the answer here is yes. We're crossing this ridge here to get to the hinterlands over here. We do this in summer, and we also do this in winter. For every mountain range you cross, you move one column to the left. So we are crossing one ridge, so we're going to move one column to the left. And that's in both seasons for us. So we have average precipitation in summer, and we have average precipitation in winter. That means that our target output temperature is this chap here. Now, just a quick note, conditions can change based on the time of year. So let's say, just for argument's sake, instead of having average precipitation in summer, we actually had low precipitation. What you do then is you always take the lowest precipitation. You take that value in the year-round column, if that makes sense. Now, in our case, it doesn't matter because they're both the same. So we just stick with the average column here. And also, we're going to need to make a note of this. So average summer, average winter. So I'm going to pop back over to the map. And we're going to go average winter, average summer. That will be important later. So our temp is 5 degrees. We ask the question, is our region below this value? We see that it is, right? We have 3 degrees, negative 1 degrees, 4.5 degrees. Everything here is below our 5 degree value. Therefore, it's cold. So evaporation is nerfed. So we don't produce an arid region. We produce a D region, a continental region. So we mark it as continental. And that's the basic shtick. Repeat that process for each of the step regions. The more complex the region, the more detail you need to go into, etc. At the end of the day, you should end up with something that looks like this. So there we go. Having factored in evapotranspiration, I can see that for all my arid regions within this D band, only this bottom southern portion will remain arid. Everything else is going to get reclassified as a D climate. And we got in our precipitation patterns here. Now, just a quick note, when we say high or average or low, this isn't in respect to like the highest precipitation one can get on the planet. This is more relative to barely any precipitation at all. High relative to almost nothing, just so we're clear. The other thing is, it might seem like an awful lot of work to do all of this just to determine that, hey, the closer you go to the poles or the higher up you go in elevation, things get colder. Ergo, steppes and deserts become declimates. Why not just make a cutoff above a certain height or above a certain latitude? B climates can't exist. Why not do that? Now, most of the time, that will be the case. There will be kind of a nice little latitudinal divide between all D and all B, but it's not always so simple. If we check out Greenland, for example, famous for being extremely far poleward, we see that way up at the tippy top, we have regions of steppe, of arid climate. So for the most part, the closer you go to the poles or the higher up you go in elevation, the less likely you are to get B climates, but it's not a truism. Sometimes the geography will just conspire to give you these weird kind of like anomalous climates. Doing this algorithm will find those areas for you if they're present on your world. So I think it's worth it. It takes a lot of time, but I like it. So with that, we're almost ready to start placing our climates. I'm just going to go time lapse through carving out this section out of the D climate band. Delightful. Let's get placing those climates. Let us begin our journey with the DXD climates. These are the very cold winter subpolar climates. They go in regions within the D climate band where the winter temperature is below, brace yourself, negative 38 degrees Celsius. That is so ungodly cold, it hurts my soul. Now, fortunately for the inhabitants of our world, DXD climates are basically constrained to hypercontinental zones. So we really shouldn't see too many of these climates, if any, on our worlds. So like if I whack on the winter temperature map here, we'll see that on Janar, like the coldest it gets is negative 31, 32, that sort of thing. Really cold, but not like DXD cold. And that makes sense, right? Because we have no hypercontinental zones. Oceanic, subcontinental, continental. That's it. No hypercontinental zone, no DXD. Thank me later, Cretaceans. Next, we're going to try and suss out the DXA climates. These are our hot summer continental climates. They go within the D-band in any regions where the summer temperature is above 22 degrees Celsius. Something like that. DXA, done. Next, we venture forth to the DXB climates. Now, just like with the CXB climates from the previous video, links in the usual places, things get a little tricky, or at least in principle get a little tricky. That's because definitionally a CXB climate zone occurs within the D-climate band in any regions where there's 4 months or more above 10 degrees Celsius. If a quarter of the year or more is above 10 degrees Celsius, you got yourself a DXB climate. Again, to recap the previous video, we have but two temperature maps, one summer, one winter. So to make this work, we're going to have to pull a few strings, and the strings we are going to pull is that we're going to compare the summer temperature to our continentality maps to determine whether or not at least 4 months are above 10 degrees Celsius. So to do this, we're going to follow these guidelines. Oceanic zone, summer temperature 15 degrees or higher, DXB. Subcontinental zone, summer temperature 16 degrees or higher, DXB. Continental zone, summer temperature 18 degrees or higher, DXB. And finally, hypercontinental zone, summer temperature 20 degrees or higher, DXB. So following these guidelines, let's do a little time lapse, shall we? All right, DXB done. And finally, DXC. Dead easy here, just the remainder of the D band. If it's not DXB or DXA or DXD, it is shock horror DXC. Done. We're in the home stretch, boyos. We are nearly there. Exciting times. All we got to do is we just got to carve apart these zones based on precipitation pattern. Now, given that we factored in a new methodology of accounting for precipitation here, things are a little bit more complicated than the previous video, but the worst of it really is over. So what we got to do is we got to chuck on our measurements that we made before. Remember, we recorded high, high, min, min, average, average, etc. This is where this comes into play. I'm also going to select all of those arid regions, or the regions that were arid here. And then I'm going to pop over to this fine table here, which tells me exactly which patterns map to exactly which climate zones. So for example, this one here is high in winter, high precipitation in winter, high precipitation in summer. It's in the dark band here, so DFC. So it would fall under the all else column here. It fits none of these three up here. It goes all else. So this is DF something or other. Again, we're in the DXC band here. So this is DFC. Dead easy. All I'm going to do now is fill in all of these regions. Done. Delightful. 9 times out of 10, this is going to result in F climates, as in DFX. But every so often, something a little bit more interesting will pop up. And now we go back to what we were doing in the previous video. Let's mark in our DSX climates now. These are our dry summer climates, our Mediterranean-influenced continental climates. If there is precipitation in the winter, but no precipitation in the summer, then it's a DSX climate. So I'm gonna select my winter precipitation, all of this blue region here, subtract my summer precipitation from that selection, and I'm left with all the regions that are dry in summer. Time-lapse mode engaged. Thank you. Okay, that is an ungodly amount of Mediterranean influence continental climates, but that is what the precipitation told me to do. Next, we're going to mark in our dry winter climates, so our DWX climates. If there's any sort of precipitation in summer, but none in winter, it's DWX. So we do the reverse of last time. We select the summer precipitation and subtract away the winter precipitation from that selection to leave us with all the areas that are dry in winter, but wet in summer. Let's do it. Okay, dry winter climates, done. And finally, we throw in our DFX climates. F standing for wet year-round. And the cool thing is, just like in the last video, all the remaining red regions here are wet year-round. Precipitation in summer, there's a small little problematic part here that's an error on my part. This should be wet year-round. Time-lapse mode, engaged. All right, D climates done. And what that means is the whole planet is done because, as always, off camera, I finished off the rest of the world. So this is where we're at the start of the video. And this is our complete climate map. Start of the video, complete map. Very nice. So excited. Oh, now speaking of deserts being eroded into, notice that our deserts were ringed in steppe regions. And then when I cut into things with our D climate band, it kind of broke up that steppe region. Make sure if this occurs to you, you put back in the steppe region as per the B climates video, links in the usual places. So that looks a little like this. So this is it after having cut in with the D climates, and this is it with a new steppe region adjusted and put in. Delightful. Now, you could totally leave it here, call it a day, and be like, climates done. But if you want extra credit, you could do some incredibly quick checks. Now, I tell a lie, actually. Incredibly quick is the wrong words to use there. It's not quick. It's extremely tedious. But ultimately, the product at the end of the day would be just that little bit more robust. So let's do some checks. So it's worth noting that not every type of climate zone can neighbor every other type of climate zone, right? Makes sense. Like, it would be an impossibility to have a tundra climate abutting a rainforest climate. That makes no sense, right? There would be some intervening climate zone to bridge that gap, possibly many intervening climate zones. So that's what we're kind of going to address in this kind of checker step, this final checker step. We're going to like go through our various climate zones and go, okay, can this climate zone here border this climate zone here? If yes, great. If not, can I put something in between it? Now, like I said, this takes forever, so I'm going to give you the general run through, show you an example, and then just off camera, I'm going to complete it and we can go compare and contrast. So for example, if we pop into this region here, we have CFB, a CFB climate zone, an oceanic climate zone, abutting a DFB, a warm summer continental climate. Can we do that? Well, luckily, here is a list of all the D climate zones. And here's a list of all the climate zones these climate zones can touch. So if you have a DFB climate like we have here, you just check the list and go, is there CFB written here? Yes, there is CFB. So DFB and CFB may well touch. Excellent. Most of the time, because this procedure tries to be as realistic as possible, most of the time, the climate zones you'll have drawn will go together okay. But every so often you might need to adjust. And I chose this region in particular because if we look up here, we have CFB neighboring DFC. We have an oceanic climate neighboring a subarctic continental climate. Does that work? Let's check our DFC band here. Scroll across and you'll see that there is no mention of CFB. So we do not find CFB climates neighboring DFC climates. So we're going to have to run some sort of transition climate zone. Now, which one is largely based on studying what Earth does and what climate zones are available in the vicinity. So we have a DFB knocking around here. I wonder, can I extend this up to create a realistic bridge? We know that CFB and DFB can touch. We just checked that. Can DFB and DFC touch? DFB, DFC, they can touch. So we could use this as a transition zone, just extend it up, use it as a transition zone to get a more realistic kind of layout of climate zones. And you can see this happening on Earth, obviously. This is everyone's favorite Scandinavian country, Denmark. That's a joke. I know it's Norway. Don't at me. If we look down the south here, we have a CFB climate zone, oceanic, going to warm continental, going to subarctic. Now, at the very coastal fringes, something slightly different happens, but in any way meaningfully inland, this is the transition we see over and over again. If we have a look at Western Canada, it's a bit hard to see. I can't zoom in anymore. I might zoom in a little bit more in post. But in the valleys here, you'll see that you have CFB, the low-lying regions. Then we transition to this blue, the warm summer continental zone, transitioning into the teal, the subarctic. So there is natural precedence, and we have this climate zone knocking around, so let's fit it in. Something like that. If this sounds like your bag, you would go through and check for each and every climate zone, not just in the D band. So, screen grabbing at the ready, here is what all the A climates can touch. Here's what all the B climates can touch. Here's what all the C climates can touch. Your Ds and your Es. Oh, and one last thing, sometimes these transition zones can be so small that it wouldn't really show up on a world map, so you have a little bit of wiggle room there, particularly in areas of high elevation. Don't feel like you have to do all this checking. I would say certainly for the lowlands, extra credits for high elevation regions. All right, I'm going to do all this checking. I'm also going to tidy up some of this pixelated nonsense going on here. I'll do it all off camera because it's just shockingly boring to watch. Through the magic of YouTube editing, Janar, its final state looks like this. Hopefully a little more organic. Here's a before and here's the after. There was very little for me to change in terms of the checks. Most of this is just making stuff look kind of organic. And that's it. Climate zones completely done. Time for me to finally get some sleep. As always, folks, thanks so much for watching these climate videos. I hope you enjoyed this one. I hope you enjoyed all of them. I want to give a massive shout out again to Ross Bay Geo, resident geography expert, for helping develop this methodology. And I think the results look class. So next time we're going to do something decidedly unclimate zone related. So stay tuned to find out what that is. Have a great one, folks, and until next time, Edgar Rouse.